time to start adding all the minor details which I either forgot to include or decided to include later due to the fact that I first wanted to paint the model. As you may see, I have already included some metallic tint to the, in this case, the shovel and the hand crank in the back. It's not super shiny silver, it has been painted in a dark metal coat and then tipped on the edges with Tamiya X10, which is, I believe, gunmetal, although this is a very shiny gunmetal. And now I'm going to add the metallic cable. I'm doing this by using super glue, and this might have been a stupid decision. Adding one section at a time. I added one of these sections first, then I need to, let's look at the picture. I have to crawl it around here and then return it again to a position over here. It's a nice addition to these tank models, but I sincerely wished they had included a optional plastic version, because if I turn the tank around, and here you may see additional details which I added to the axe, if I turn the tank around, there is a cable already over here, which is the plastic one, to which you have to include, in this case, another cable, the ropey one. The problem I have with these cables is because they are metal, as you can see, they spring in a particular position, which means they're extremely difficult to get them on the tank looking like a real metal cable, unless you really pull on them to make them a little bit more straight. And there is the problem: if you're going to pull on them, they're going to break off from the tank itself. So that's where I mean, they should have included an optional fully plastic one, so you have the choice either add the plastic one or the metal cable version one. I was just about to give up on those springy cables. I tried to glue on one on the, as you see, on the side of the tank, which I said, and I needed to glue on these little things over here. These are the pieces which is going to supposed to keep the cable in one place. Now, as I said, I had glued the cable on this side of the tank, so I was trying to straighten it and then glue in that little piece, and no matter how long I waited, every time I released the tension on the cable, it sprang back. At one point it yanked this part off and it just flew right past me, and I still need to find where it is. So I thought, well, I just yank off these cables and forget about the cables. And then something occurred to me. I'm sorry. I have here a bag of rope, and this is rope, but miniature rope. These were all of a model sailing ship which I've made, and I had a lot of spare rope in this bag. And this black string has almost the same size as that metal wire, which I misplaced again somewhere. I really need to clean up this table. Anyway, so this is a lot more flexible, of course, than the metal wire. So what I did is I removed the metal wire and I replaced it with the rope or the string, which are now glued into these hooks. So what I can do, I can just wet this rope and it becomes more and more flexible, and then glue this to the tank. So let's try this. On another note, I have about these spare tracks. These went on very well. What you need to do is you have to take two pieces of the track you can make. This is the smaller piece and the larger piece, and you just glue it together I've already painted it in a dark metal color, and all you need to do is just hang it on the hooks on the turrets, which, no, other way around, like so. See? And there she is. And then just a drop of glue, and it's in. So, yeah, I really like that system. So let me finish off the rest of these tracks, and let me try if this works. It's my least favorite thing to do, painting figures. I'm really bad at this, so I've checked some other videos, YouTube videos of people making these figures. And those are either more crappier than mine are looking, or they are so extraordinarily good that I won't even try to emulate these. I'm doing the best I can. I have one figure over here, and you can see I have done most of his uniform. That is to say, I have done the base coating of the uniform, the base color. This set of 8 figures has 2 different kinds of uniform for strange reasons. We have the overall brown looking uniform, and we have the green uniform. So I just do whatever the instruction manual says. I've glued all the parts together of the figure. I'm not quite sure if that was a good idea, but I glued them all together. So all the bags and all the sacks and all the drinking stuff and guns. It's very windy outside, by the way, so you'll probably hear some things falling over. So what I've been doing now is putting some base coat on it. Now I'm going to start on the face, which, as I said, is my favorite part. I have put some darker skin tone on it as a undercoat, a base coat. And now what I'm going to do, I'm going to use some lighter skin color, and I'm going to dry brush, and I don't need to tell you what that is, dry brushing, but it will enhance the upper surfaces of the details by gently brushing on a dried brush with that lighter color. So what happens is only the raised parts of the details will now get this lighter color, which will be the edges of the ears, the bridge of the nose, and some other elements like the upper cheeks and the chin. So we get a little bit more detail, a little bit more definition of its shapes. Luckily these are very good figures, they look very nice, so even though my paint job is crappy, at least I can make something out of it. Now they're not finished, not by a long shot. I've been trying to get a feeling of what kind of diorama I want to do with these models. I already know that I'm going to use both of them, although I must say that every kind of diorama I try, this is standing in the way. But I am most likely going to use it anyway. My plan is to make some sort of a diorama, and you may see the outline which I made around here, and I made some sketches. It's going to be something like a train tunnel. This area is simply the road, or maybe the train tracks heading this way, and the tunnel entrance is over here. So the tank and this half track is halfway inside the tunnel, and there's a reason for that. What I want to do is in the center over here, I want to make a little campfire, and the suggestion is that it's near nightfall. It's in the Ardennes. There may be some snow and some wet stuff over here. Anyway, it looks not very nice outside though. So our intrepid soldiers are camping for the night, or at least going down for the night near this in this tunnel around this campfire. And because this campfire has LEDs flickering, and the entire tank's sorry, the tank and the vehicle are inside the tunnel. What I'm hoping for is to get a light effect from this campfire that they actually light up the tank and the vehicle from this source alone. So maybe some rocks or something around here. So I have them standing around near the campfire, getting warm. Because of this light, we get a dramatic effect. Maybe gonna push the tunnel entrance a bit more forward so the tank is completely inside the tunnel. I'm not quite sure what the English word for it is, but when you're a child, you use an old shoebox and you cut out a little peeping hole and you make a little diorama inside the shoebox and you watch through the peeping hole. I'm not quite sure what the English word for it, but we call this in Dutch a kijkdoos, a viewing box. So this is a bit like I'm trying to do around here. Before I do anything, of course, I need to add the decals. There are a lot of decals in this model kit. All kinds of color digits. You can actually point your own digits on this model tank. There are several variations which the instructions suggest and give you information about the SPG apt 501, which stands for PZ stands for Panzer, apt for uptiling, so it's department Panzer department 501, first, second and third company. I'm not quite sure what the S stands for, I need to look that up. Since the half track has a red and white letters, I am going to use the red and white in combination, maybe some particular number on it. One small thing, however, there are eight of these German crosses decals, numbers 6 and numbers 7, included on the decal sheet, but they are not mentioned anywhere on the instruction manual where they're supposed to go. So I have to look it up if they actually do go anywhere on this model. And that is for now it. One small thing about weathering, which is also something going to be done after the decals. Weathering. Kingtiger tanks were relatively new on the battlefield around 1944. So they, as far as I know, were deployed in the Ardennes as one of the first actual battlefield. Maybe they were in Russia, but not quite sure. So the amount of weathering on this tank or battle damage is going to be minute. It's going to have some dust, of course, and maybe some mud over here, but not like the previous Tiger tank with all bent kind of sides and real dents all over the place or large damages. So I'm not going to do that on this tank. Now what are we going to do now? First, I'm going to make the bridge in cardboard. Tunnel in cardboard, and then going to use some little stones, little bricks, to simulate a stone tunnel. Well, this is the mock-up I have made. It's out of cardboard, as you can see. We have some molds currently in order. Molds which will create bricks of the correct size to shape this tunnel entrance. We could make it a bridge entrance, of course. We can make it a bridge, as you can see. It's still, the options are still viable. Let me move this camera a bit. Okay, we can still make it a bridge, hold on. But I still like the tunnel. Now there is a small problem with this tunnel. I have to, of course, place something in the back to, one, make sure that the tunnel actually does not opens up in the back and doesn't look like a tunnel anymore, and B, I want to create that dark area inside where the light effect is going to work. But if I'm using a backboard like this, I run the risk of you be looking inside a tunnel from any kind of position, and you'll be seeing a black backboard. I could, of course, try to paint or draw a tunnel entrance in here to make it show that the tunnel goes on until forever. But that would, you could see that when the light is on inside the tunnel, you will be seeing that it is a painting. Now, I just came on with a brilliant idea to make a back section and still make it look realistic. And it is not making a flat backboard, but to have the tunnel collapsed. So if I remove the tank for a minute and the half track, as you can see, I have used some piece of cardboard to make sure that the shape remains in shape. So instead of making it a straight backdrop over here, what I intend to do is have it like this, and then have the ceiling collapsed, or like look like it is collapsed, so it's full of bricks and debris over here. And that is something I think is a great idea. The bridge is too high anyway. I mean, the opening is too high anyway. If I put a tank in there, you can see the tank would fit, but it doesn't add to the dramatic effect. So what is most likely going to happen, I'm going to add a layer of, I believe, styrofoam or foam plate to simulate the landscape, which will increase the height of the road so that it looks like this, which would make it easier for me to have the tunnel entrance collapsed. So the next step which I would need to do is to turn this around, and as you can see from this drawing, pencil drawing, I'm probably going to start making some cuts over here and then have the tunnel entrance coming together. As I said, this is just the paper mock-up. It is to be used for me to stick the bricks I'm going to make out of concrete or plaster. It's going to be used to stick them on this this cardboard, and to have the landscape on top of it. So it will be a rather large diorama, but with all the light effects it might work. So we have the tank over here, as far back as possible. I actually wanted to have this one in the back, and I'm not quite sure if it's going to work. So it might just even come to the point that I'm not going to use this anyway. It's not a real shame to it. So we have the tank over here, or no, let me rephrase it. We're going to have to, hold on, I could of course have this buried inside under the rubble. No, that will be a shame. No, so we have the half track in the back over here, we have the tank over here, and we have the, yeah, I really would like to have the, maybe if there's fire over here perhaps. I'm really wondering if I'm going to use the half track, because I wanted the campfire as far away in the back as possible. But let me first start by making this collapsed tunnel and then see how far. Next plan of attack with the mock-up a bit modified. You can see I've simulated a bit of a curved back in the back. And I added these flaps. This is going to be the circumference of the diorama plateau. But before I'm going to stick it onto a plank, because this is the quite obvious opposite of what normally I want to do. Normally I use a plank and then build up the diorama frame first. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to add blocks of this stuff. This is insulation foam, which I managed to scrounge off a builder's site. They were throwing it away. It's almost impossible to get hold of this stuff in the Netherlands. I know in certain countries you can go to a DIY store and pick up these things, but I've never seen these in my DIY stores in my neighborhood, except for those polystyrene with these little white little balls, which are impossible to work with. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to cut with using serrated knives. I'm going to cut several pieces off this block, which is going to create a simulated surface. When I mean surface, I mean simulated level of the floor. And taking into consideration that there is going to be a fire or a fire pit in here, which of course requires me to put in some cables, we're going to at least have a height of about at least 1 to 2 centimeters inside this tunnel complex. But as I explained earlier, I want to actually have the tunnel a bit lower, so we're probably going to have a bit higher and then use the height to simulate some craters and stuff like that. Anyway, we're going to just make some cuts and see what kind of surface I can create. So I've been cutting up this board of foam, as you can see, insulation foam. I've created this shape by just using the bottom of the cardboard tunnel entrance as a template. This is a temporary, of course, temporary shape. And let's see if we can see it. Hold on. All we need to do is just shove it over here inside the tunnel. And we have this shape over here, which goes in front of it. And here we have the entrance to the tunnel. Can we see it on camera? Oh, yes, we can. So when I put our little friend, Mr. Tiger Tank, inside the tunnel now, we have the correct height. And we have actually some sort of a, well, surface for the tank to stand on. Yes, it is a bit high over here. I'm probably going to lower it over here, but because you can easily just, as you can see, cut it using a serrated steak knife. Now, you can, of course, use a knife made out of a piece of wireframe, metal wireframe, put a battery or some power on that frame, and it will slice through it like butter. But for the time being, these serrated knives will work perfectly. And we're going to most likely put some layers of paper over it before we start modeling the actual terrain features. I've been using some leftover blocks, as you can see, to create this over here, but we have to do it all over. What I'm also going to do, and this is completely reverse in how I normally make a diorama. Normally I just take a plank of a particular size and then build up the diorama parts on it. This time, as I said, I'm going to start working on the shape and then the surface plank. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm now going to find myself a piece of paper, a large piece of paper, glue everything on it, continue on the rest of the back of the tunnel. And when everything is stuck on that piece of paper, I then can actually find that plank. Currently on order are two molds, two silicone molds. One which will make me bricks for this tunnel entrance, scale 1 to 35. And one mold which is for pavement slabs. I'm still not sure, maybe I'm going to make this into a train tunnel, but what I could also do is suggest that it's not a train, but it is a car tunnel, so I do not need to put on train tracks. But I'm still not quite certain what I'm going to do at the moment. I'm still haven't convinced how I'm going to do this, but first let's concentrate on the shape, and then we'll see how we're going to finalize this entrance, being it car tunnel, train tunnel, or maybe just for a part of a military base. So I have put some paper mache on the edges to make sure that no big holes left, and I've started adding layers upon layers of plaster. That of course all needs to dry, and I'm going to do it layer by layer and section by section until the entire section is plastered. As you may see, I have added a few stones because yes, the two silicone molds are in for making little stones, but I would like to continue with that in a later video in the next video series for the Tiger. So I was actually thinking of making this entire Tiger 2 build into 3 videos. It's gonna take some bit longer, but I hope you will agree with me that adding this diorama, and yes, I'm gonna make a hole for the fireplace later, with this diorama, it will be a nice thing to have it watch to grow into a nice diorama. So thank you for watching, and yes, we will continue of course with the stones and the plaster, and then we will start looking how we're gonna put in the tank and all the other elements, and then finishing off the diorama, and we may actually finish with the Tiger tank in episode 4, who knows. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to click and subscribe. I really need those subscribers, guys, because well, with the new YouTube rules, I just lost my monetization, which was the only thing which kept this channel alive at the moment. So please do me a favor, subscribe, like the channel, and we'll see each other next time in episode 4. Bye!